Good afternoon, students. So, continuing some of the general topics, today I would discuss with you the issue of complications. And once again, my email address is there, vkkapoor.india@gmail.com. Please feel free to communicate with me on any issue. Aviation industry, especially space program, is considered to be an absolutely safe program. The chances of error there are very, very, very small. But still, we all know that sometimes accidents do happen there, as it happened a few years ago when this young lady from India lost her life along with some others. And as compared to aviation and especially space industry, when we talk of medicine, medicine is considered to be much unsafe, very unsafe. In fact, some people say that if you take the numbers into account, medical industry is very hazardous. The basic principle of medicine, as we all know, is primum non nocere. That means we should not do anything which harms the patient. We should always try to do some good to the patient, and if possible, we should try to make their lives better. But whether we are able to do that and how to do that in the best of the way, we will discuss. So in medicine, and especially in surgery, whenever any intervention is done, and these days a lot of physicians also do interventions, for example, endoscopy and other procedures, errors are quite frequent. It would not be wrong to say that they are common, and very frequently, although not intentionally, inadvertently, the patients get harmed. Obviously, surgery causes pain and discomfort, which is probably a part of the intervention, but sometimes it causes disability, and less commonly, it can cause death also. And all this results not only in discomfort, but prolongs the hospital stay and increases the cost of treatment, whether it is on the patient, on the employer, or on the society. So what do we call them? In many medical reports, they are called adverse events. The common term used is complications. The patients may take them as mistakes or errors on our part. And a court of law, like the Consumer Protection Forum, may consider it to be negligence. But this is just play of words. For example, during the Japan-Korea War, when these women were used as kind of to satisfy the invading Japanese army, later on or in the literature, they were called comfort women, a very fancy, respectable term. So the word actually doesn't matter. The fact is that these are events which harm the patients and which cause discomfort to them. I got this figure from one of the lay media coverage that in the US, as a result of medical errors, more than 180,000 deaths, not errors, deaths occur every year, which translates into one jet crash every day. So if every day in the newspaper you read about a jet crash, you would say that this is something very unfortunate, but that is what happens in the healthcare system in the US. So considering our population and considering the quality of health infrastructure that we have, you can imagine what would be the number. I have no idea. I don't think there is a data like that in the Indian healthcare scenario. Also, it is very well established that adverse events or complications, there is always underreporting, including mortality, there is underreporting. There is this program in the US which is called National Surgical Quality Improvement Program, which looks at the events happening in the hospitals covered under them. And when they compared at the same hospital, this is a very good Massachusetts General Hospital in Boston, attached to the Harvard University, that in the morbidity and mortality meeting, which is conducted by the department or by the hospital the mortality rate as well as the morbidity rate was much lower, as opposed to when it was looked into by another team into the records, both were much higher. And there are several reasons for that. And you could forget things. Different people may use different definitions. There may be a change of team. But most important is the human nature, that whenever something untoward happens, we have a tendency to deny it. We have a tendency to turn away from it. And then, of course, we think that, no, it cannot happen in my hand. And obviously, we are afraid either of a bad name or a bad report with the administration. In general, if I can say so, there are three important causes of complications. And they are lack of knowledge, that you don't know. So something which you don't know, obviously you can't do it well. Second is lack of skill. As we talked the other day, that skill is very important in surgery. So you have to have good skills, even if you know how to do a procedure. Unless you learn how to do it, you will not be able to do it. And then, of course, in surgery, decision making is very important. When to operate, when not to operate, how to suspect a complication, what to do to diagnose it, how to manage it, when to reoperate, when to conserve. So every step involves a very intelligent decision making. And if we don't have that decision making skill, and this is something which you can never learn sitting at home, reading books, listening to lectures in conferences, or just as you are listening to me, this is something which you have to learn on the spot. How your seniors, how your faculty, how your consultants take a decision, whether that decision retrospectively proves to be correct or not correct, and if it is proved to be wrong, what was the reason, what was the wrong decision which was taken, that you have to learn on the battlefield itself. So going into details, the causes could be related to the diagnostic procedure or preparation, because many of these are invasive, like fine needle aspiration cytology. In our own clinical practice, we have had an FNAC related large hematoma, subcapsular and intraparenchymal hematoma in the liver, which kept expanding, probably because the patient was on some antiplatelet drugs. And in spite of surgical intervention, the patient died. So just an FNAC resulted in death of the patient. We have had a death of a patient following a CT scan because of a contrast reaction. We've had deaths following ERCP because of an ERCP related complication, and then other percutaneous interventions like percutaneous catheter drainage of an abscess or a collection, percutaneous transhepatic biliary drainage for cholangitis. In the theater, it could be related to a faulty equipment. For example, there are instances where suddenly the gas supply stops and the patient suffers from irreversible anoxia. It could be cautery related. Staplers can misfire, insulation of laparoscopic instruments. So you have to be very well versed with all the gadgets, all the equipment that you use in the theater. I don't know, say that you should know how to repair them, but you should be at least able to say whether they are functioning properly and what are the major problems in these equipment. It could be a failure of the system. For example, wristbands not used by all hospitals to identify patients. It could definitely be related to the procedure. It could be the surgeon, either inexperience or even overconfidence. If you are overconfident of doing something, you can cause a complication. I remember when I was a senior resident, like some of you, I thought that lymph node biopsy is a simple matter. And I probably was overconfident at that stage. And then inadvertently, I caused an injury to a major vein in the neck. And was taken care of by one of my senior colleagues, it could have resulted in a major disaster. And then, as I said, that your colleagues who help you in managing patients could be responsible for some of the complications. But ultimately, since you are the captain of the team, you have to be morally and ethically responsible for them, although legally they may be responsible for it. So there are various ways that we can classify complications. They could be general to any operation, for example, venous thromboembolism, wound infection, or they could be specific to an operation. You could classify them as minor, major. They could be medical or surgical. They could happen early in the post-operative period or late. they may be anticipated that you know that this is going to happen after this operation. So you are prepared for it, but they could be unexpected also. And then they could be preventable, avoidable, or something which you can't do about. Same way, you can say that they could be expected. For example, if you have a soft pancreas, an undilated pancreatic duct, we know that in many instances, this anastomosis will leak. They could be unusual complications. For example, post-gastrectomy, we had a bleed, but it was from the omentum. And they could be acts of omission that you forgot to do something, or they could be acts of commission that you did something which you should not have done. Same way, I usually look at them according to this very broad classification in my mind. They could be minor complications following a major operation. For example, when you do necrosectomy for severe acute pancreatitis, wound infection invariably occurs, but in my mind, it's a minor complication. I'm not much bothered about it. Or it could be a major complication, but following a major operation. For example, pancreatic duodenectomy, PJ leak, we all know that in about 10 to 20% of cases, in anybody's hands, they occur. So you are prepared for it. But what worries me is a major complication following a minor operation. For example, a bile duct injury in laparoscopic cholecystectomy is a major complication following a so-called minor operation. Although I always say that you should not consider any operation as minor, but relatively smaller as compared to other operations. So this is something which is unexpected, unacceptable. You could grade them that what is the discomfort caused to the patient, how much is the prolongation of hospital stay, whether because of the complication the patient required to be shifted to high dependency or intensive care unit, whether the complication required further investigation or intervention, how it increased the cost, and obviously if it resulted in death. So taking these criteria, the commonest classification or grading of complications which is followed is what is known as a Clavien-Dindo classification. These two surgeons, they propose this classification. You can read them in your textbooks or articles. And basically it is starting from simple to requiring medical treatment, requiring intervention, and then life-threatening, requiring ICU care, and obviously death of the patient. So this is the most commonly followed system of grading of complications which most of us follow. There are some preventable complications. For example, hypothermia, as I discussed the other day, during a prolonged procedure, especially in elderly or small children, aspiration because of regurgitation, bed sore, again is a preventable complication, and DVT and pulmonary embolism to a large extent today is preventable. And in high-risk patients, you should always use venous thromboembolism prophylaxis. There are certain unforgivable complications. You can cut the aorta, you can cut the IVC, you can cut the ureter. Maybe you can kind of get away from it by explaining the difficulty during the operation. But if you operate on a wrong patient, if you do a hernia repair on the wrong side, or you operate on the wrong limb, if you give a wrong drug, using the incorrect dose or incorrect route, for example, something which was to be given as an infusion, you gave bolus, mismatched blood transfusion, cautery burn, steam burn, and retained foreign body. These are all unforgivable complications, and you must make every effort not to have one of these complications. Just to give you some examples, when you are dealing with the pancreatic necrosis, if there is a colonic perforation, you operate, there is peritonitis, you do colectomy, and then you have a bleed because of a slipped ligature because the tissues were inflamed. So you should have been a little more careful, but this is a technical complication. Drains and tubes can cause various complications. It could be wrong indication. For example, a small calcified cyst, hydrated cyst in deep in the parenchyma of the liver, surgery is either not required or is difficult. You should have thought of either leaving the patient alone or dealing it with in some other way. As I said, wrong patient, again, it has happened. Even in the airway industry, a Jet Airways plane landed in Lucknow instead of going to Varanasi. And then this example I gave the other day, that a wrong body was given to the relatives when two bodies were airlifted by Air India. wrong site. This is an article I read some time ago. I've forgotten the citation, but 1,000 hand surgeons were asked, and they said that at least 20% of them have had at least once wrong side surgery, either left to right or the wrong digit. And similarly, when a child was to be taken up for a frenulotomy, instead of the tongue, it was done on the penis. Delay in diagnosis is also a complication. So laparoscopic cholecystectomy, patient is unwell, but you delay the diagnosis of bile leak, and by the time peritonitis has set in and patient goes into sepsis. Ulcerative colitis, restorative proctocolectomy done. The patient was having bleed, which was causing iliac vein compression, and this happened in our hands. We misdiagnosed it as deep venous thrombosis because there was unilateral edema. So we gave anticoagulation to the patient, and with that, obviously, the hematoma further increased in size and the patient died. Wrong surgeon. If you are a general surgeon and you do hysterectomy, especially elective hysterectomy, as long as nothing goes wrong, nobody will say anything. But the moment there is a complication, you will be questioned, and then you cannot justify doing a hysterectomy, especially if a gynecologist is available in the same hospital, or the patient could be referred to another hospital where a gynecologist was available. If you do it in an emergency when nobody else was available, fine, but not an elective. And similarly, I know that many urologists saying that because they are basically general surgeons, they do lap coli, but probably it would not stand in a court of law. A delay in surgery, an infected liver hydrated, which ruptured into the lung. This again happened with us, but in this case, fortunately, we could save the patient, although an unnecessary thoracotomy had to be done. Wrong timing, acute cholecystitis, you think it is biliary colic, and then you do a lap coli. And because you are not experienced enough to do lap coli in acute cholecystitis, it's not a contraindication, but it requires more skill, more experience, and then you can have a bile leak. And similarly, in pancreatic necrosis, if you go in early, that is a wrong timing, because now it is very well known that in pancreatic necrosis, you should wait for at least 2 weeks, preferably 4 weeks, for the necrosis to get localized before you do surgical necrosectomy. Wrong approach. For a supracarinal esophageal cancer, if you do a transhiatal or try to do a transhiatal esophagectomy, that's not the correct approach. You should be doing a transthoracic operation. And similarly, if you suspect gallbladder cancer either on ultrasound or CT, and still you attempt to do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy, this is wrong approach. By and large, suspected gallbladder cancer should be treated by an open operation. Yes, there are some centers which do laparoscopic extended cholecystectomy, but that's only in specialized centers in experienced hands. Wrong attitude during the operation, a casual attitude. So you are doing a gastrojejunostomy to palliate gastric outlet obstruction, and you just pick up a limb of small bowel and do the anastomosis without caring to look for and confirming that what you are taking out is the jejunum. This again happened in our hand. Fortunately, the mistake was recognized during the operation and the procedure was corrected. So instead of jejunum, a loop of ileum was taken up and anastomosed to the stomach. Wrong anatomy, very common mistake. Common bile duct mistaken as cystic duct during lap coli. Right hepatic artery mistaken as cystic artery. During pancreatic duodenectomy, common hepatic artery mistaken as gastroduodenal artery, which is then clipped and divided. And again, some other mistakes. During a cervical sympathectomy, brachial plexus misidentified as cervical sympathetic chain. This again happened in my hand in my early career. Round ligament mistaken as fallopian tube. There was this patient who wanted a tubectomy also. So we said, okay, we will do it. Why should we call gynecologist? And then when we ligated and sent the segment for biopsy, it came back as fallopian tube. So because we are not familiar with that anatomy, we mistook the round ligament as fallopian tube. And ureter is very commonly mistaken for a vein or a nerve by both us as well as the gynecologist. So doing a wrong procedure, for example, doing a major resection in presence of distant metastasis, which you missed during surgery, is a useless exercise. Sponge count, And not only sponge, people can forget children also. And the British Prime Minister took his small daughter to a washroom and then forgot her there. So retained foreign body, as I said again, is an inexcusable complication. And it usually happens when there is a long operation. So you tend to use too many sponges. More so when there is an intraoperative complication. So there is a disturbance of your piece and your protocol. When there is a change of team, either the surgeon or the nurse, then you pack for bleeding, or sometimes you pack for pack the stoma so that there is no spill. Sometimes the gauze piece goes with the specimen and you forget to account for it. Between the drapes, it can be there. And then wet gauze pieces, if they are clumped together, instead of counting them as two, the nurse may count as one. So these are some common situations where you will have a problem with a retained gauze piece or a sponge. Wrong follow-up, for example, in a hydrated disease patient, you forget to prescribe albendazole for the follow-up, or you fail to prescribe prophylactic antibiotics for post-splenectomy, or there is a patient who had an endoscopic clearance of CBD and a stent was placed, you did a lab coli but forgot to inform the patient that the stent is to be removed, and then the patient comes with a stent block and cholangitis. These are again complications which can happen even after discharge from the hospital. Now, unfortunately, some of the complications can cause death also. And globally, when a number of deaths are looked into, the two common causes are coronary artery disease and cerebrovascular accidents. But unfortunately, surgery comes as the third cause of death globally. And therefore, deaths because of surgery are very common, as I said. The number of deaths caused by surgery is even more than number of deaths caused by HIV, tuberculosis, and malaria combined. Mortality is a very definite event, unlike complication where two people may differ. There is no difference as far as definition of mortality is concerned. But still, in medical terms, there are different definitions of mortality. For example, a surgical patient may die preoperatively. So for example, that patient with liver hydrated who had a rupture into the chest, if you don't diagnose it in time, if you don't operate upon in time, the patient would die. But then in your data, you would say that this was a preoperative death, so you would not count it as surgical death or postoperative death. It could be an intraoperative death, death on the table, which again, you may say that this was because of anesthesia-related issues and you may not count it. Postoperative deaths, post-procedure deaths. For example, either pre-op or post-op, you get a PTBD done and there is a PTBD-related complication like bleed and the patient dies. You may say, no, this is not a surgical death. This patient died because of a procedure done by the radiologist. And similarly, now the concept of 30-day and in some procedures even 90-day mortality is there, because it has been seen that following major procedures like liver resection, liver transplant, pancreatic uridectomy, esophagectomy, patient may not die in 30 days, but patient doesn't recover also in 30 days, and prolonged complications can cause death even after 30 days. So good centers are now reporting on 90-day mortality, which is definitely more than 30-day mortality. And then your patient may be shifted to another ward. For example, if I have operated upon a patient with portal hypertension, I've done a shunt, but patient has post-op bleed, upper GI bleed from the varices, and patient is shifted to medical gastroenterology ward, and she dies there. So that death is not counted in my death count because the patient was shifted. Or this is a common practice that patients leave against medical advice, either because they have no hope or they have run out of money, or it could be that the patient is referred to another hospital. So all these deaths, sometimes trying to be clever or not trying to be true, we exclude from our surgical mortality. But that should not be done. If you want to be true to yourself, every death, whether it is in any of these categories, must be included in your audit so that you know your correct and exact death rate. And these are clever ways of excluding deaths from your audit, but they are not the ideal things to be done. So mortality again could be something which you expect. So if you operate upon a child C liver cirrhosis patient with encephalopathy and coagulopathy, although today we would probably not operate upon such a patient, then you know that this patient is going to die very, very likely. And then there are certain procedures where you anticipate death. You know that it is likely to occur. For example, infected pancreatic necrosis, where patient has already gone into multiple organ dysfunction. As the number of organ dysfunction increases, the risk of death increases. It could be something which is not unanticipated. So you know that there is a small possibility. For example, you do pancreatic duodenectomy in an old man who has coronary artery disease, who is hypertensive, who is diabetic. You know that it is possible. Unexpected death means you do an esophagectomy or a PD in a young, fit patient. So in this subgroup, you should ideally not have a mortality, but it is okay. But something which is unacceptable is that you do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy in a young, fit woman, and either because of a bleed or because of a bile leak and related complications, she dies. So this is something which is unacceptable. Again, the mortality could be because of the patient, multiple medical risk factors, nutritional status. It could be the treatment the patient is receiving for the disease, like steroids and ulcerative colitis. It could be the disease itself. For example, as I said, multiple organ dysfunction in necrosis, or patient with gallbladder cancer, surgical obstructive jaundice, having hepatic failure. It could be investigation related, procedure related, anesthesia and other issues. Nursing related also, an elderly patient who has a distended stomach, where a rice tube is not placed, he's not fully aware, fully conscious. In the immediate postoperative period, he can aspirate and die. And this also has happened with us once. By and large, surgical causes of mortality are mainly bleed, leak, and sepsis. And the unrelated causes are myocardial infarction, deep vein thrombosis, and pulmonary embolism. These are some of the causes of sudden death in hospitals, MI, which to some extent, if the patient is symptomatic, can be diagnosed by ECG. Arrhythmia again can be diagnosed. But pulmonary embolism is a silent killer because we don't suspect it, and it's difficult to diagnose. And similarly, severe dyselectrolytemia also is a cause of sudden death. Now, bleed could be preoperative. For example, a patient with trauma, which you are managing conservatively or observing, the patient could die post-procedure, as I said, FNAC or aspiration of a hemothorax or hydrothorax. Intraoperative bleed, like a major injury, vascular injury, IVC injury during hepatectomy, or it could be post-operative, a primary bleed from a ligated vessel, or a secondary bleed. What is secondary bleed? That you have an anastomotic leak, and then this leak forms a collection which gets infected, and then that abscess erodes into an adjacent vessel, for example, the gastroduodenal artery after a pancreatic duodenectomy, and it causes pseudoaneurysm, which then ruptures. This usually happens around a week to 10 days, whereas the primary bleed usually happens in the first few days. So all these complications and mortality can unfortunately lead to a litigation and a medico-legal problem, and therefore it becomes a complication for you also. And the most important thing which comes to your rescue in case a case is filed against you is the consent. What prevents a case? Case being filed is communication, as I said last. You keep talking to them about the disease, about the patient's condition, about what you are planning to do, about what are the possible risks, and some of this forms part of the consent process. So that is why consent should not just be a written piece of paper signed by you and signed by the patient or the relative. It should be a two-way communication process where patient should have the freedom and the confidence in you to ask if he or she has any doubt. And all this then should be documented as a written document with signatures. So if I have to kind of summarize complications and mortality following surgery, I would say that yes, we are all human beings. So we all kind of mess up things which we are trying to do. And same way, however careful we are, we will definitely keep causing complications and keep having deaths. But you should be comfortable to own your complications and to accept them. And being able to admit your errors or complications, especially in an academic department, is a mark of strength. You should be able to say that, yes, this complication occurred in my hand. And then you should be able to analyze as to why that complication occurred. And most importantly, you as well as your team, the others, should learn from that complication as to how to prevent or reduce the risk of that complication in future. And that is why you should learn from others' complications. And therefore, it is our responsibility to talk to you about our complications so that you can learn from our complications and you can try to avoid these complications in future. And these are some famous quotations on complications which these people have made. And basically what they tell us that, yes, as long as you do something, things will go wrong. As long as you do surgery, you will have complications, but you should be able to learn from them and improve your performance the next time. So for you, the young residents, as I said last time, you should know. So that means you should read and you should know your subject. You should anticipate complications. So you should know that after an operation, what complications can occur so that you keep looking for them. For example, if you've done a thyroidectomy and you go for the evening round, you have to keep looking at the respiratory distress, because even a small bleed under that wound in the neck, the first thing it will cause is respiratory distress. And therefore, you should be able to suspect them. So unless you know and you are thinking about them, you will not suspect them. And once you suspect them, you should do appropriate investigations to recognize them, to diagnose them. And you should know that how these complications are to be treated. Again, whether you can treat them or whether you need to call your senior colleague to treat them. And all of us, when a complication happens, should discuss a complication in what is known as a surgical audit meeting. And everybody in the team should learn from these complications. And therefore, in your clinical practice tomorrow, when you become a surgeon, young surgeon, especially if you are working in a small hospital where you don't have support of seniors or other colleagues, you should choose your patient well. So selection of patient, indication of surgery, you should prepare the patient well, give some time to either build the patient's nutrition up, take care of a bad chest, bring down the level of jaundice, correct the coagulopathy, hydrate the patient. Then obviously you should do the procedure well, and you must do the post-operative care also. Take it very seriously, because that is how you will pick up these complications in time and treat them. You should keep the patient and the relatives well informed to avoid medico-legal problem, and you should document well so that in case a case is filed against you, you can protect yourself. And lastly, as a resident and as a young surgeon, you have a duty and responsibility towards yourself also to look after yourself, which means that, as I say, that a resident should be able to eat whatever he or she gets, sleep whenever you get time, and in between read when you have free time. So thank you once again. And this is my email address, pkkapoor.india@gmail.com.
Thank you, sir, for another wonderful lecture. We'll throw open the field for questions from anyone. So the if I can set the ball rolling, suppose I'm doing a lab cholecystectomy. Of course, I had spoken about the possible morbidities and all that. Suppose if I cut the bile duct, should I come out, inform the patient party, then go back, repair it, or I repair it and come back and tell them, or don't tell them at all?
No, there is no question of not telling them at all, because they will come to know from somebody or the other, and it is much better that they hear it from you rather than from another person in the team or in the hospital. Whether to come out in between and tell them and then go on to repair, I would probably do the repair and then tell them, so that because otherwise if I tell them and then I take few hours to repair, during that time they are suffering from great mental distress. So I personally would probably do whatever is required and then come back to them, unless I feel that I am not competent to repair it and the relatives may feel that they may want to go somewhere else with this injury. In that case, yes, definitely. So that I should have that confidence that they don't tell me that, why did you do it? We would have wanted to get it done somewhere else. Of course, when to do repair and when not to do repair, that's a separate topic in itself. So maybe when we talk about safe cholecystectomy or bile duct injury, we can do that.
So regarding mortality, unexpected mortality, now you're talking about a patient who has contrast-induced anaphylaxis. How to deal with such patients and how to deal with their relatives?
Unexpected mortality is a very difficult problem to handle. I remember when we started the department, this was in early 90s, we had a young lady whom we took for, at that time we used to do open cholecystectomy. So open cholecystectomy and CVD exploration, everything went on well. And in the post-operative period, she had a sudden death. So she was young, there was no doubt about MI. She was not a high risk for venous thromboembolism. And we really didn't know what is the cause of death. Now, in this situation, it becomes very, very difficult to explain to the patient as to why it happened. And then, ideally, in such situation, the senior most member of the team should do the communication. It should be done in a place where there is no disturbance, where there are no onlookers. The relative should be well seated comfortably. There should be somebody to offer them a glass of water in case they break down, which is quite likely. But I can say that it's a very, very difficult situation to handle.
And again, sir, over the years, what I had noticed, even with my own self, if something goes wrong, you don't feel good at all. You don't feel hungry. You don't talk to anyone, you can't sleep properly. How to deal with yourself when these morbidities happen? And actually, this is a very difficult thing. There are times when we operate on a patient this evening and we don't want the sun to rise the next morning.
Yeah, especially when you have an unexpected complication like a bile duct injury during lab coli or an unexpected mortality, it becomes very difficult. It causes a lot of stress. It causes, in these days, it causes a lot of fear also, because you are afraid whether a medico-legal problem will come. But before that, it causes stress. It causes lowering of self-esteem. You think that you are not a good surgeon, whether you should be. I remember there was a time when I had 5 or 6 consecutive acute severe necrotizing. This was the time when we used to do the necrosectomy relatively early, and 5 or 6 consecutive patients died, and I had this, and I was not in the beginning of my career. This was in the middle of my career as a surgeon, and then I spoke to one of my colleagues that should I stop operating on these patients, because last 5 patients that I have operated have died. So those feelings do come, but I think one has to get over them. And as I said, that most important is that both you as well as others in your team should take this as a learning opportunity. Whatever has happened, we can't reverse it. But you should go into the details of that complication, that mortality, discuss it threadbare as to what went wrong. And the basic principle of audit, maybe we will have a session on audit also. The basic principle of audit, academic audit, should not be who was wrong. The idea is not to find who did the mistake. Idea is to find what went wrong and how to prevent it from occurring in future. So that is why most good academic departments have an audit session. We have it every week, every month, and then every year, where we discussed each mortality and each major morbidity into great detail, trying to find out why it happened and how we could have prevented it. I know that in the corporate sector, it becomes a difficult thing because there are so many other factors. But again, in the corporate sector, the senior most surgeon should try to create an environment and atmosphere amongst the working colleagues that an academic audit should be done as far as possible so that everybody can learn from it.
So any questions from the floor, if anyone wants to ask a question?